Do your vector tile base maps feel more complicated than they need to be? It might be because they are. Take it from me, there's no faster way to scare off folks that are trying to customize your base maps than to try and force something like this onto them. An overly complex style with tons of duplicate layers that are confusingly named, and you gotta customize each one at every level of detail. Nobody wants to mess around with that. Now, if you want to start making more efficient vector tiles in ArcGIS Pro, you need to leverage four key pieces of functionality. So let's talk about scale-based symbols, scale-based sizing, alternate symbols, and display filters. Hey folks, welcome back to the CartoRedux channel. My name is Tommy and I design and cook basemaps for a living. Now these four techniques have completely changed how I think about basemap design and what it takes to author a fast, efficient, cartographically rich vector tile basemap. More importantly, using these techniques is going to allow you to create a style that is clean and concise, easy to navigate, and intuitive to customize. When designing a custom vector tile basemap, the name of the game is simplicity and efficiency. Here's an example of what I mean. You want to try to author your map with the fewest layers necessary. You'll also notice in this map, there's no group layers. So minimize use of group layers as much as you can. Also, keep your layer names descriptive, but short and concise as possible. These layer names have to stand on their own. Remember, what you see in your table of contents is what users are going to be interacting with when they're customizing your base map. So be sure to keep that in mind. Before we jump into all of those juicy details that you came here for, let's make sure the rest of our map is set up properly. First things first, make sure you disable this setting. Draw up to and including the max scale ranges. Scale logic is handled differently in ArcGIS Pro from how things used to work in ArcMap. If you import a map document in MXD, this option is going to be enabled. It's a compatibility setting. This makes sure that any MXDs that you import to Pro, scale dependencies on group layers and labels will behave just like you authored them in ArcMap. Problem is, this isn't how scale dependencies are handled when rendering vector tile layers. And since we're authoring a vector tile base map, we want that authoring experience to match as close as possible to what our cooked base map is going to look like when viewed over the web. If you create a new map in Pro, this box is off by default, but just double check and make sure the option is off. So uncheck the box. Now, while we're in here, let's also make sure you remove any reference scales, set that to none. We also want to set our default scales for the map. I know this is going to be a web mercator base map, so I want to make sure that the scales used by this map align to those tiling scheme scales. To do that, go into the scale selector, pick customize, use the ArcGIS online scales. This is going to set the stage for some critical UI elements. It defines the scales that populate dropdowns for your layer scale dependencies and a bunch of other stuff that I'm going to show you in just a minute. Do this before you start messing around with any of the next steps. Trust me, it'll save you a ton of rework and the headaches associated with all of that. Also, while you're in here, I find it really helpful to enable this option as well, only display these scales when zooming. This is a great new-ish feature that locks how you zoom in and out on your map to specific scales and basically treats your map like it's a web map and snaps to those specific levels of detail in the tiling scheme. Now for the fun part, let's get into our map symbology. And let's not get too carried away though. But just for the sake of time, let's just focus on a single thematic layer. Let's focus on roads. Now, why roads? Well, I'm lazy, but also because I typically will use all four of these multi-scale mapping techniques on this one layer. And just a quick heads up, I do recommend that you go through these next steps in the order that I do. I found that this definitely kind of shortens the time that you iterate on these things. So take that for what it's worth. As I mentioned, for the sake of time, I do have some things set up already. My road layer is set up with unique value symbology. I've got my values grouped together and I've set some meaningful labels. And before we get going any further, let me pause labeling just to speed things up a little bit. Next, let's talk about symbol layer drawing. Now this isn't new by any stretch of the imagination, but it's important nonetheless. If you're familiar with ArcMap, you'll notice things may look familiar in the basic tab. These options match what you had in ArcMap symbol layer drawing options. And with this enabled, our map is so much better. But what about this advanced tab? That sounds scary. This is a little different, and I'm gonna need you to think a little bit more like Bob Ross here. This presents our various symbol class components in more of a painterly approach. We start with the bottom layer. This is the first thing we lay down on our canvas. Then we follow that up with some titanium white and maybe some Van Dyke browns. Now you may notice that what we're seeing is a lot of extra things in here, and that's because we're breaking apart individual symbol classes into their component symbol layers. What do I mean by that? Well, here's the major highway symbol class, and if we look at the symbol layers tab, we see this symbol is made up of two stroke symbol layers. We have the road casing and the centerline stroke. Back over to the advanced tab. So we've got all these road casings drawing together in a group. And in these last few groups, we then layer on the centerline strokes for ramps, highways, major highways, get that all onto our canvas. Now, becoming familiar with this can be a bit mind-bending, and it definitely took me a fair bit of time to wrap my head around this. So don't feel bad if this feels intimidating. You can go back to the basic tab for the time being, but there may be some things that we do later that will force us down the path of the advanced route. So just want to give you a heads up there. All right, symbol layer drawing, check. Next up, scale-based symbology. So with ArcMap, you could only have scale dependencies on things like group layers, layers, and label classes, but with ArcGIS Pro, we can control the scale dependencies of individual symbol classes now, which is really cool. Now, as long as you're using unique value or graduated colors, you'll have this little scales tab, and that's where so much magic happens. Now, instead of using layer scale dependencies and definition queries, we can control and fine-tune which symbol classes display at specific levels of detail. So let's dial a few of these in now. Now you can either click on the stop and pick the scale from the drop-down list or just drag the sliders. The scales that you see match those scales that we defined a few minutes ago. See what we did there? All right, this is looking great, but there's still more that we can do with this layer. So let's fine-tune how our road symbols increase in size as you zoom in by using scale-based sizing. So to enable scale-based sizing, just click on the symbol class, head over to symbol properties, and then the symbol tab, and then just put a check mark in this box over here to turn on the feature. Now the sliders and stops control the overall symbol line width at specific scales, and then it just interpolates the line widths between the stops. So I'm gonna set my major highways here to start out at 1 to 4 million at 3 points. Let's increase that line at 1 to 1,000 to 12 points. So that's a good place to start, I think. Let's check out highways. And I'm just gonna work my way down through each scale, just experiment with different sizes, zoom in and out, make sure those transitions are looking good. And then just lather, rinse, repeat for each of these symbol classes. Now, as you make your way down to the mid and larger scales, you may need to further tweak symbol sizes. In some cases, an extra stop can really help with transitioning across those levels of detail. Again, the goal here is to strike a nice balance of having enough features on the map to meet your needs, while also retaining a good visual hierarchy among those features. We'll give our map one more quick walkthrough, make sure that our features are showing up when we want, that these line thicknesses look good. I think that looks good. Nice. Something is bothering me, and it's the local roads. Let's see if we can use alternate symbols to address that. So these local roads, these just kind of like jump out at you and when they turn on at the scale. And I'm all about gradually introducing features into the map. I don't want to just slap you in the face with them. So first try to address this with scale-based sizing, but you may find that reducing these symbols too much can sometimes make them a bit muddy feeling. So let's try alternate symbols. So from the scale tab, just select the symbol that you want. Let me just make sure this is my local road symbols. And back to the scale tab, right? And then click the alternate symbol button. This is gonna add another symbol, and then you can refine the scale range that it's gonna transition from your alternate symbol to your base symbol. And with your alternate symbols, you also may need to further tweak the scale-based sizing a bit. And one thing that helps here is to set all of your alternate symbols to match your base symbols. And then I'll set my alternate symbol to the same range and sizes. That way, there's no trying to line things up at those transitions. It's just the same size across all ranges. And whenever that transition happens, it's just seamless between the two symbols. Use alternate symbols if you want to change the symbol structure, like removing the casing or removing the center line, or changing the color of a feature as you zoom in and out, or change the color transparency of the feature. But one pro tip on color transparency, because this can bite you later with line features especially, you'll see here when the caps for each line segment overlap with color transparency, they're a bit darker, like those colors add up. So it's distracting, that's not good. So a better option here, instead of color transparency, go ahead and set it to get the color that you want and dial that in. And then what we're gonna try to do is match that color. So I'll just use the color picker option here, I'll grab that color. And then, you know what, let's just refine that color a bit. So let me flip over to HSV mode, tweak the saturation and value sliders a bit, much better, that's much more subtle. And like I said earlier, if you can get the look that you're after with scale-based sizing, use that. But make sure that you're not using alternate symbols just to resize the line. That's what scale-based sizing is for. Now, I'm really liking where this is at, and the map is feeling pretty good. except for these small and mid scales. And this is where we can apply additional generalization or thinning techniques or display filters. This is going to help clear up some screen real estate by reducing some of that feature density. So we'll just head over to the display filter tab, flip this switch to turn them on, click add another display filter or give it a meaningful name. Add my expression. And thankfully this data has got an attribute, this ACC field here, which basically identifies roads based on their relative importance. So I want to use category 1, 2, and 3 roads. And then we'll just move this slider to about 144K. And this defines the valid range for when this SQL clause is going to be applied. And beyond this, and it lifts the SQL clause. And basically there's no SQL clause being applied. And as you can see, it's really effective at reducing some of that clutter and density at those small and mid scales. Our road symbology is dialed in. I think we can finally turn on our road labels and see how these look. Now I built out these label classes beforehand, but I just want to make sure that these label class scale dependencies are behaving the way that we want. So make sure we got a good balance with label density and road density. Just sanity check when labels are displaying versus when the road symbols are showing up. Now I usually hold off on displaying labels one or two levels of detail after I've added the road symbols. So I usually lead with the symbol for one or two levels of detail and then start labeling once I've got more screen real estate to play with. Also, I like having my label classes set up right along with my symbology layer in the table of contents. It just makes for a more streamlined, neat and tidy table of contents, but also things like display filters you only have to apply once. So instead of having a separate label layer that's just labels for your roads, just put them in a single layer, much more streamlined. And remember that warning I gave you before, that heads up about the symbol layer drawing. You may have this little message now saying that you've got to use the advanced view because of the alternate symbols that you added. So get ready to live, folks. So this is looking pretty solid. I like this a lot. All that's left now is to cook this thing and we're off to the races. Now, I know what you're thinking. This sounds like a lot of work, and that's because it is. But I think you owe it to your users to put in that effort, because if we've done things correctly, we should have taken something that looks like this clunky, cluttered, cumbersome mess of duplicate layers and turned it into this. A nice, succinct list of layers, giving us a clean and concise style that's easy to navigate and intuitive to customize, alleviating any pain points as much as possible. Now you pull that off, and folks customizing your base map aren't even gonna realize all the work that you put into this. And that's okay, because for them, it's easy and it just works. And in my mind, there's no greater compliment than that. Because if you ask me, that's the whole point of this. That's the benefit of thoughtful design and smart cartography. What more could you ask for? Well, for me, I'd ask you to show that like button a little bit of love before you head out and check out this series where I talk you through how to create vector tiles and raster tiles in ArcGIS Pro. I'll see you over there. Thanks for watching. See ya.